So it is my honor to welcome Rashauna Johnson at today's Fellows Colloquium. And having taught at Dartmouth for almost a decade, she is now Associate Professor of History at the University of Chicago. So it is universally acknowledged that Rashauna Johnson is among the most distinguished, creative, sharp, and collegial of historians, and an amazing sleuth in archives of the Atlantic world. She is the author of Slavery's Metropolis, Unfree Labor in New Orleans During the Age of Revolutions. Focusing on New Orleans as a major portal, Slavery's Metropolis contextualizes the global history of slavery within the daily lives of individual enslaved people in the Gulf of Mexico. Published by Cambridge University Press in 2016, and then again in 2018 in paperback, it was awarded the Williams Prize for the Best Book in Louisiana History and the H.L. Mitchell Award by the Southern Historical Association for the Best Book on the Southern Working Class. Slavery's Metropolis was also named a finalist for the Berkshire Conference of Women's Historians Book Prize, honorable mention for the Urban History Association's Kenneth Jackson Award, and a finalist for the Frederick Douglass Book Prize. She is currently at work on her second book project, A History of Family and Region, Slavery and Emancipation in Rural Louisiana, and I think we'll hear a little bit about that today. She grew up in New Orleans, Louisiana, and she serves extensively and generously within and beyond the profession. She regularly delivers lectures to public and private high schools, and she has taught GED and literature courses in correctional facilities. Please welcome Rashauna Johnson.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that very generous introduction, Krishna. Thank you, Professor Gates, to Krishna, Ms. Velma, and all of the Hutchins staff. I'd like to thank my fellows, and I'd like to thank my family and friends who are here and possibly online, either now or later. Thank you. This feels very much like a family reunion, which is on brand for what I'm going to talk about today. So thank you. Moving in a slightly different direction, I want to send warm thoughts to our colleagues and friends at UVA, and especially in Black Studies at UVA. Those men were affiliated with Black Studies there, and so I cannot imagine that grief. And so it is with both grief and excitement that I want to present material from my current project. I am in the middle of things very much, so I look forward to your feedback. As a quick FYI, I will discuss sexual violence and exploitation throughout, and so I don't want that to take anyone by surprise. But I will be judicious as best I can, but I just want to make sure that that doesn't take anyone by surprise. In the spirit of a family reunion, I'm going to start by picking on D. what is this?
Oh, wow. So we are in New Orleans right now.
No, we aren't. Where did you go to college?
Wait. that's LSU?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, that sure is. Yeah. I remember that big hill and the big tree. Okay.
Yeah.
That's Congo Square.
I respect it. Okay, so this is LSU's campus. These are LSU's mounds. These are ancient mounds on LSU's campus, thought to date back to the archaic period, so 8500 to about 3000 BC. And it is physical evidence, you know, alongside other kinds of evidence, that this region was long inhabited by diverse and competing peoples, indigenous peoples, including the Homa, the Bayugula, the Biloxi, Choctaw, Chitto, any number of indigenous groups. Also in this picture, well, not in this picture, but adjacent, sort of imagine, There's almost immediate proximity to the Hill Memorial Library, which houses Hill Memorial Library, which houses the special collections, an invaluable collection, where many of us do archival research. And finally, it houses, you see in this image, LSU's famous trees. LSU has more than 1,300 live oaks on campus. This physical campus dates back to the 1920s, not long after Billie Holiday would protest through elegy, quote, "Southern trees bear a strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root." And I use this image and its evocative juxtapositions to broach a basic but profound question: where do we look for history? In recent years, scholars of race and slavery have measured the archives and found them wanting. The piercing critiques of Sadia Hartman, Marisa Fuentes, and others caution all of us, but especially members of the Historical Guild, I would be one of them, right, against an uncritical reliance on and regurgitation of empirical facts found in the archive, a methodology that they would argue does not examine or critique violence, but in fact reproduces it. They rightly call us to meditate on the sources of our sources and in our narratives to speculate about the voices and experiences that exceed received ways of knowing. As they note, however, the violence of history does not persist solely because of the archive, nor is the imperative to or constitution of silence stable over time and space. One, and I think about this from Jim's point last week, we are in an archive, right? This is the hip hop archive, a unique space to be sure, but one that even when we count only traditional archives, includes places like Moreland Spingarn at Howard, the Amistad Research Center, the Schomburg, and other repositories dedicated to Black history, and a long history of formidable Black archivists, Dorothy Porter Wesley, any number of other people, and people in this room who are producing archives, digital projects, and so on. And I think it's important that when we have these conversations, we talk about the ways that Black people themselves have worked to preserve important aspects of their own histories. Two, silences are themselves products of history. I'm a historian. We think everything has a history, right? In some instances, conventional archives, however problematic, and I was just having this conversation with my cousin on the front row, silences are themselves products of history. And in some instances, conventional archives, however problematic, allow for one kind of counter-narrative. So for example, in the research for my first book, which Anid, my dear fellow, wanted to sort of put here, and we kind of negotiated and sort of put it over there. Thank you for that, it's really kind. In my first book, I confronted archives that overflowed with the literal receipts of urban slavery, even as I inhabited a city, New Orleans, that paradoxically commoditizes the inheritances of slave culture while effacing actual enslaved people from history and memory. And so these kinds of archives can be useful in our attempt to suss out both what happened and what is said to have happened, to use Trio's phrasing. And so that brings me to my current project, Strange Roots. So after the first project, which centers an Atlantic port city and its worlds, I am, perhaps predictably, interested in the plantations that rested at the heart of the Atlantic plantation complex. Specifically, I want to center family and intimacies in the history of slavery and empire over the 19th century. And to be clear, I am not interested in a triumphalist or romantic narrative of Black family. I'm after something more nuanced. In her classic article, Tense and Tender Ties, Ann Stoller calls for attention to the ways, quote, intimate domains, sex, sentiment, domestic arrangement, and child rearing figure in the making of racial categories and in the management of imperial rule. At the same time, and I'm sorry Faith couldn't join us today, but she sent a lovely email. At the same time, I'm interested in what Lisa Lowe calls, quote, the intimacies of four continents, which Faith described in depth in her presentation, so I won't spend a whole lot of time here. But briefly, Lowe sees intimacy as a heuristic to explore race making and subject formation. Lowe seeks, quote, to unsettle the dominant notion of intimacy as the possession of the individual, coded as white, bourgeois, and so on. Ultimately, Lowe writes, quote, I would wish to frame this sense of intimacy as a particular fiction that depends on the intimacies of four continents. In other words, the circuits, connections, associations, and mixings of differentially laboring peoples eclipsed by the operations that universalize the Anglo-American liberal individual. In a second sense, Lowe would have us take seriously, quote, the political, sexual, and intellectual connections and relations among slaves, peoples of indigenous descent, and colonized laborers. These and other conceptual frameworks I want to bring today to an examination of this particular context. As usual, I have three very straightforward research questions. It was very, very basic. One, how did a region go from North American borderland in a weakened Spanish empire at the beginning of the 19th century to a center of US cotton and slavery by mid-century, and then a site of Jim Crow modernity by century's end? Two, how did enslaved and emancipated people of African descent in this region work to create and recreate themselves, families, and communities on sites of bondage? And three, finally, how might their and their descendants' memories and diasporic practices be read as historical texts that offer counter-narratives to the dominant ones? As Jennifer Morgan writes, quote, there are obscene abstractions at the heart of the slave trade that reverberated across the social and economic categories that racial slavery would call into being. Race thinking, speculative economic thinking, political economies of both enslaved people and slave owners, arguments about ethics and finance, and the relative autonomy and safety of family life among people of European and African descent. Today, I hope to layer two sets of stories to show how settler colonialist slaveholders' intimacies depended on the denial and exploitation of the productive and reproductive labor of their bondspersons, a process that cemented their own mastery and advanced competing and successive imperial regimes and agro-capitalist schemes in the lower Mississippi River Valley. Yet, as Morgan, Tira Hunter, and others note, people of African descent, especially women, used the techniques at their disposal to refuse, resist, and rewrite the fiction of their kinlessness. And through reading their everyday acts, we get a better sense not only of anti-blackness, but also the ways that black people, and especially black women, have long challenged its faulty, if tenacious, premises. All right, let's get started. Harriet's Borderlands. All right, so a little bit of context because I am a historian. One, so the French claimed this region as part of its early explorations, right? The city of New Orleans was founded in 1718. But as Kathleen Duval writes, quote, beyond the borders of New Orleans, the French did not do much of anything in Louisiana without Indian assistance. And it's important to really center the importance of indigenous people in this region, especially through the 18th century. Britain acquired this region that I'm going to talk about in 1763 in the aftermath of the Seven Years' War and expanded its claim to include Natchez the following year, and they brought with them hopes of commercial expansion. All right, this is a land grant housed at LSU Special Collections. So this is one such land grant from 1768, and it is for Daniel Hickey and his heirs, that's an important line, and it secured 500 acres in West Florida, quote, for the proper cultivation of land, end quote, within a designated period of time. So I want to raise a couple things from this document, and then I'll keep going. First, and his heirs, right? I think that's a very important phrase to meditate on in this context, right? Because it gestures to a notion of futurity, right? They aren't simply thinking about giving this land to this person. They're thinking about giving this land to this person who then, through his own propagation, right, would continue to exercise dominion over this territory, right? And so there's a notion of futurity through reproduction that's nestled in this document. Two, and conceptually, I really couldn't have teed this up better, right? Like it's really on the nose, right? So that's, you have this ornate design with this florid penmanship. You have this image of George III in the upper left corner. It guarantees, right, that's a word, right, it guarantees 500 acres. But I think it's also, this is also an opportunity to reflect on the difference between sort of rule by paper and sort of the practice on the ground, because, of course, there remain challenges to this property regime, not the least of which was indigenous people's resistance. And so I want to flag the kind of false sense of power then that this document gives us that sort of presumes that, you know, colonialism was a sort of fait accompli when this was really sort of another move in an ongoing match. Okay, so during the American Revolution, Spain allied with France, and of course, Britain had its hands full with things going on in these parts. And so in the aftermath of the American Revolution, Britain ceded both East and West Florida back to Spain. And so this happens in 1783. I am going to spare you the details, but just note, seriously, like, too much. Yeah. Any one of these things is a rabbit hole. But take my word for it that the territory that I am referring to as West Florida itself changes throughout the period that I'm discussing, and no one needs to, like, no, we're not doing that today. But the point is that the way that that land itself is determined, is defined, also shifts. Okay, so after Spain takes possession of this region, this is the period that Gwendolyn Midloe Hall refers to as the re-Africanization of Louisiana, right? They invigorate the slave trade. And you see this in the archival evidence, right? The records of Spanish West Florida. I picked these at random. 1785, you see the sale of Jupiter from the Senegal Nation. 1787, 21 Africans from the Gold Coast. 1787, sale of Wana from the Pular Nation. We also see evidence of self-purchase and manumission, which is something that is in some ways specific to the Spanish Empire and that we don't necessarily see in other contexts, and that's worth noting. But, and this is where the fights start, the net is a massive expansion of the enslaved African population, right? And so those things are not sort of separate. I want us to think of them together, right? Sort of some of these rights that we talk about a lot in the context of Spanish Louisiana exist in some ways as a mechanism for making sure you can better enslave a broader set of people. And so that's something to kind of keep in mind. And as with anything I say, I'm happy to talk more about this in the Q&A, but I have enough to say as it is. All right. And so I don't want to just make this overwhelming. All right, it is a well-attested tradition in early chronicler rights that as early as 1802, fat old Levi Harrell of Charleston District, South Carolina, sent his son Hezekiah, quote, to explore these southern wilds for a home large enough for his old folks, the little ones, the slaves, and the herds. Hezekiah, as in this case, right, this is the British Empire, this is the Spanish Empire, same technology, right, land grants based on family size, which, again, you know, they're counting people in the family and translating that into acres on the ground, right? It's a truly insidious process. Okay, Hezekiah secured a land grant from the Spanish, one based on the size of his, quote, family, and others joined him. Between 1806 and 1808, the Harrell men secured nearly 2,500 acres. Okay, so this, I'm going to step away from the mic briefly to point, but I won't talk. But I will point to sort of the rough area I'm talking about, which is kind of here. Mm-hmm. That makes sense. So this is kind of Louisiana as we often think about it, Florida, and so on. Okay. From above, this is a win-win. The Harrells and the other settlers get land and wealth. The Spanish officials use the settlers to domesticate the land, right? This remains a counter-revolutionary site as the common winds of Republican and anti-slavery revolution threaten global elites, right? This is the era of the Haitian Revolution, the French Revolution, revolutions across Spanish America. And so this is supposed to be a counter-revolutionary site to preserve the monarchy and to preserve slavery. I don't have much archival information about the people that the Harrells enslaved in this early period, so I draw on another set of sources to imagine the plausible experiences that those people might have encountered. All right, so the first is a quote from a letter from George Kimball, excuse me, a Revolutionary War vet and fellow South Carolinian who moved to this region, and one of his jobs was to be the custodian of his nephew's enslaved woman, Harriet. Excuse me. So this is from March 6th, 1806. quote, "As for Harriet, I have her with me, not because I am in need of her, but I cannot hire her to my satisfaction. We have reason to expect troublesome times, and I will not hire her longer than 1 month at a time. I do assure you that I don't intend to fall in the hands of the Spaniards should a rumpus be kicked up, and wherever you find me, you will find Harriet, if life lasts. I shall set out for New Orleans tomorrow morning with my crop. I hope when you see Harriet, she may likely be in a way of increasing her stock, for it appears that she has got a husband," end quote. Here, we see a lot of things, right? We see Kimball's anxieties about the war and the prospect of war between the U.S. and Spain, and his solidarities, even as he is reliant on on New Orleans for exports, right, the export of his crops. But we also see that he is prospecting on Harriet's marriage as a route to increase, meaning childbirth, right? That this would result in a new slave. And I'm sorry, I know this is all hard, but we have to face this stuff, right? That he's prospecting on her increase, right? And Jennifer Morgan has written brilliantly and beautifully about this, and I'm going to draw on her analyses throughout. But for Morgan, she argues, right, free people birth kin, enslaved people racialized as black birth capital. And this is a founding moment in the history of race and racial capitalism for Morgan because it points to the ways in which, right, reproduction becomes this mode for producing and reproducing capital for slaveholders. By 1806, 8 months later, Harriet reportedly had given birth to a daughter and was being hired out to earn wages. Harriet next appeared in Kimball's correspondence in 1808. Kimball wrote that the Spanish monarch declared that he did not intend to cede the territory to anyone and that settlers had, quote, full liberty to import as many Africans as we please, so that I expect we shall be crowded with that kind of people. This explains why, in a period of shifting loyalties, so many planters in this region were content to remain part of Spain. The transatlantic slave trade was still legal there, and this is at a moment when, in other, sort of in the US context and the British context, we're seeing the criminalization of the transatlantic slave trade in 1807, 1808. In this region, as being part of Spain, right, one of the advantages is that they would continue to enjoy access to the transatlantic slave trade. Kimball continued in that letter, quote, "There is but one thing would induce me to purchase Harriet Ben," which I'm assuming is her husband's name, "and the young child, and that is her being raised in the family," end quote. And so in that sense, he's offering to buy this enslaved family unit from his niece and nephew and to take possession. Now, on the surface, this seems like beneficence, perhaps paternalistic beneficence, but beneficence, right? Given the sort of the role of the auction block and the terror of sale, we're used to sort of thinking about the ways that this might seem like a good thing, right? You can stay with your family, right? And that's, I don't want to minimize that, right? Like, that's a real thing that we should note. At the same time, and I think that the context tells us, right, this also represents this kind of stability. There's a deep pain in this stability, right? There's exploitation through this stability because it comes with the promise of future increase, right? And in this era of economic turmoil, political uncertainty, this nuclear family becomes something of a hedge for the people who own them, because the idea would be that they could continue to produce new enslaved people in an era when the international supply, you know, becomes unstable. I know, I'm sorry, it gets better. Harriet was how Kimball coped with the economic downturn that followed Jefferson's embargo in 1807. And in 1808, Kimball talks about the huge economic downturn that happens in the aftermath of Jefferson's embargo, and he writes, quote, "I am just from New Orleans, and the people would be well reconciled to the embargo was it not for often hearing the stroke of the auctioneer's hammer. I was 14 days in New Orleans. I don't believe there was one day clear of sheriff sales. Nothing talked but war." And I want to really emphasize and move on, that when we talk about kind of the pain that comes in the aftermath of Jefferson's embargo, we can talk about just sort of dips in the GDP, but for these people, it means the separation of their families, because when we're talking about the soundscape of sort of the auctioneer's hammer, well, who is the property being auctioned, right? These are enslaved people, and so that's another way of sort of thinking about the multiple levels. When Kimball didn't get as much for his cotton as he expected, he hired out Harriet to cook and clean for four men, one of whom was Kimball's son Daniel in Pinckneyville, Mississippi. In a subsequent letter, Kimball writes, quote, "The thing called money is not to be found in the Floridas, and when it will, I know not." He complained it would be hard to collect Harriet's wages. Quote, "I believe she will make more by breeding than working, for she is pregnant again. When this young one is born, it will be a mulatto." I'm going to stop the quote there, but he continues by kind of joking about it, right? He attributes he attributes sort of this pregnancy to a white overseer, and he kind of makes a joke about the sort of sexual undesirability of the overseer, makes a joke about this overseer's sexual proclivities in terms of thinking about multiple enslaved women. There are a couple things to note here, however, right? One, it's entirely possible that this is kind of what happened. It's also entirely possible that Kimball himself fathered these children. And poking fun at this less privileged, poor white overseer might have been a way for him to shield his own actions from her actual owners. All right, so that's a lot. What is the point? My favorite question, like, what is the point? What is the point? While the Kimballs and the Harrells, for whom they are a stand-in here, built a familial dynasty through land grabs and African slavery, Harriet's experience of this Spanish borderlands ostensibly included, one, remote ownership by an owner in North Carolina, two, marriage and reproduction, three, various hirings because of Jefferson's embargo, four, presumable separation from her husband and child to work in a domestic capacity with these four white men, which left her isolated and vulnerable, five, sexual assault and a forced encounter that involved this overseer and another bondswoman, and six, pregnancy, perhaps by this overseer, one of those four young men, Kimball, or just about anyone else. In other words, Harriet's subjection is what allowed the Felicianas to be a happy land for people like the Kimballs and the Harrells. And that's a critical point. So in the aftermath of this, there's an 1810 West Florida revolt. Again, another rabbit hole. But they revolt against Spain, and there's brief independence before annexation to the Louisiana Territory. Okay. In 1812, I told you the region would shift. So this will be my final map, but it kind of gives you the contours of the region that I will talk about for most of this period. In 1812, Louisiana gained statehood. The Harrell sons did not participate in the rebellion, as far as I can tell, but they did fight against the British in the War of 1812. And people talk a lot about the War of 1812 as a sort of rematch, right, of the American Revolution. So the empire that their parents' generation fought against in that context. And the second bit of context to recognize here is sort of thinking about Christopher Brown's work on moral capital. As Britain is increasingly becoming associated with abolitionists and anti-slavery activism, Atlantic slaveholders became deeply suspicious. And so it didn't really take a lot of work to get them to want to fight against the British in this context. And so then after that, right, we're into the antebellum period. Migrants from across the U.S. and the world, and I won't speak a whole lot about this here, but I'm happy to talk about it, but migrants from across the U.S. and the Atlantic world assemble in this region to pursue King Cotton. As high cotton prices created an unprecedented economic boom, East Feliciana Parish's enslaved population exploded by 70%. In 1830, it was home to just over 4,600 enslaved persons, split evenly by gender, and they represented just over half of the parish's total population. By 1840, the enslaved population had grown to 8,000 bondspersons out of just under 12,000 inhabitants. Definitely a black majority, as Peter Wood would call it. And I know from some of our earlier talks, right, there's complexity around counting populations and sort of thinking demographically, but I do think it's important for us to understand sort of I have no idea exactly why Walter Johnson named his book River of Dark Dreams, but I often think about that title in the sense that that land really is populated by enslaved people of African descent. And so the territory, like if you kind of chart out the black population in this region sort of visually, it's like a dark river. I mean, if you get what I'm saying in terms of thinking about the ways black people are living in very close proximity to that river. Okay, resistance, right? So that the entire time that this is going on, enslaved people are challenging these regimes in every way that they can. And now I'm thinking about Neil Roberts' Freedom is Marronage. We can see through, say, flight, for example, that this is a political action that stemmed from deep political thought. To be clear, sometimes the reasons people ran away was to get away from intimate partner violence and slaveholder violence. But it's also the case that we see that enslaved women allegedly escaped either alone or with partners. Again, I selected these almost at random. So this is, I mean, we can talk, anything I say we can talk more about, but so this is an image of a newspaper, the Asylum in Feliciana advertiser, and it contains here, that's the bit I'm going to read today. This is from 18 January 1822. A planter in Pointe-Coupée Parish complained about the escape of, quote, a mulatto woman named Hannah, described as, quote, about 28 years of age. The planter had, quote, no doubt she is trying to cross the river to the parish of Feliciana where she has acquaintances. And so that is a kind of recognition and understanding in archival records that these folks had communities and that they understood where their communities were. And when they escaped, they tried to sometimes get to get back to their communities. Married couples sometimes ran together for similar reasons. In just summer 1822, a Pointe-Coupée planter complained that, quote, the Negro man named Toby and his wife Millie had run away. Quote, Toby is about 25 or 28 years old, black complexion, stutters when agitated, rather thick lips. Millie is a very likely wench, common stature, smiling countenance, rather blacker than her husband. She has lost one toe off of each foot. End quote. His stress-induced stutter and her bodily injury both speak to slavery's routine tortures and helps us to understand the resistance to them. Quote, they are both American Negroes, but can speak French tolerably well. End quote. So over time, the Harolds continue to gain money, right? So the 1850 US Census says that the value of Hezekiah's widow Cassandra Harold's real estate is $24,000, a number that may not reflect her debts. My favorite mathematical tween is in the room, and so I thought I should update those numbers for current dollars. So, you know, and this is not exactly what I do, right? But if you go and sort of play around with some of these calculators, that is, I'm going to go with roughly $821,000 in 2020 dollars. But depending on the measure, the number goes from anywhere from half a million up to sort of 194 million, right, depending on the measure. And so I would leave that to my more statistically inclined friends to sort through that. But either way, I think all of those numbers give us a sense of the broadest stakes of this slaveholding. She owned more property than many of the male professionals, tradespersons, and small farmers in East Feliciana. And according to the 1850 US Census slave schedules, she owned 24 bondpersons, 7 females, and 17 males. By 1860, 10% of East Feliciana's free population were millionaires in relatively contemporary dollars. How does she get that money? So this is a probate record. In this period of wealth acquisition through marriage and slavery, right, this had a very different meaning for the enslaved people that the Harolds owned. Here, this is a probate record, again, one of any number. Quote, a Negro woman named Becky, aged 50 years, and her child Caleb, aged 2 years, being repeatedly cried, was adjudged to Mrs. Cassandra Harold for the sum of $500. She, being the last and highest bidder and consenting to the terms of sale, signs this act. And so this is from August 1842. Here, an enslaved family, a mother and child, were sold to Cassandra Harrell for the furtherance of her family's mastering project. And here I think of Tivolia Glimp's work, Out of the House of Bondage, which also points us to white women slaveholders in the antebellum South. All right, I know we don't have anyone in the room who focuses a lot on African American genealogy. but I want to shift gears a little bit here, right? Because I wanted, the both and is important to me, right? Like it's hard to get through the material, the kind of material that I went through just now, and I recognize that and thank you for your patience. But to me it's essential because I think this juxtaposition is actually essential and both parts of this story I think are essential together. And I hope I'll make a case for that after having asked all of us to kind of get through such really heavy material. Matrimonial record for colored persons opened June 1866. And soon after, right, June 1866, on a Tuesday, the seventh day of the seventh month, Rachel Robbins and Virgil Harrell married. So these are, I want to distinguish, so these are colored people, right? So Rachel Robbins and Virgil Harrell, colored Harrells, married. They were the third entry in this registry. Federal legislation after the U.S. Civil War, including the 13th Amendment and the Civil Rights Act of 1866, which took aim at discriminatory laws at the state level, allowed formerly enslaved persons like Rachel and Virgil to secure state recognition of some of their partnerships. For freed persons and others like them, Tira Hunter writes, marriage, quote, symbolized new beginnings as African Americans reconstructed their families, often over long distances and in the face of continuing opposition from former slaveholders. However, and I know I'm in the room with Jim Downs, and as Jim would remind us, those long distance reunions also allowed sort of the circulation of disease, right? And so even as they contended with severe material deprivation, ongoing violence from whites, paternalism and racism from allies, and other fundamental challenges, this transition then was far less romantic than it might sound. And as many scholars of Atlantic emancipation have argued, marriage ushered in a new set of dispossessions for freed women and for freed children, right? And so we have to make sure we have a complicated idea of freedom, right? Is freedom a bourgeois, patriarchal, heteronormative household, right? Sometimes yes, sometimes no, right? And so really wanting to invite that kind of complexity. Okay, within this context, Virgil and Rachel had several children. Before Virgil, likely a widow, remarried and had more children. People had a lot of children in this period, right? As an aside, and I know John has an interest in this, this region is also the context for Angola Penitentiary, which is a former plantation that's located in this region. And there's an event actually tomorrow where I think Brandon Terry is going to have a discussion about the documentary Angola, Do You Hear Us? Voices from a Plantation Prison. And so I just wanted to flag that. It's not super central to the story I'm going to tell here, but I want to gesture toward that in terms of thinking about the ways that people are reconstituting regimes of power, even as I'm trying to tell this other story and sort of making sure that you have that on your radar. Okay, Virgil's second marriage in 1890 was to a presumable widow named Martha Tapp. They had more children. According to testimony from her granddaughter, Martha was raped by a local postman, which produced a daughter named Ruth. Ruth's daughter, also named Ruth, was my maternal grandmother. And here is my grandmother, and she appears here on a Mardi Gras Indian suit, a memorial suit, that my cousin, Veronica, wore on Mardi Gras Day 2016. And as an aside, I talked to her yesterday, and I said, I'm going to talk about you tomorrow. And she said, do a good job, and please no pictures. And I can talk more about the why she's really sensitive to pictures of this. We can talk more about that. But for now, I want to identify the people, and then we'll move forward. So obviously, this is my cousin, my first cousin, who is wearing the suit. On the front, so those are my maternal grandparents, Ruth, right, the daughter of the Ruth I just mentioned. On the back panel is Ruth's younger sister, so my great aunt Sally. So those two were sisters, and so they grew up in this parish. Here is my cousin's late mother, and on the wings that you can see on the either side is my late mother.
That's a dancing family tree.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think that's what I, you know, my joke to her in 2016 is, I mean, she's my cousin, but we grew up like sisters because we grew up in the household together. And I just kind of did my little sister eye roll, like, okay, I think this book is trying to catch up to what you are up to in this in this performance and in this suit. Because I want to conclude by using this image to meditate on the ways that my cousin here used her body, her art, and her performance to insist on kinship in yet another context in which Black family is denied, now through mass incarceration, physical and mental health disparities, climate change, gentrification, and late capitalism and anti-Blackness. And so this is the suit itself, and this is her in the street. I just love this picture. And there are many, many others. I mean, my good friend Justin Steele is here and former Hutchins Fellow, and we had this funny moment of like talking with his daughter about Mardi Gras Indians, and she just Googled Mardi Gras Indians, and my cousin popped up. And what are the first two pictures? And he's like, this doesn't happen regularly, just so you know. So in an interview in summer 2021, I asked my cousin about the suit, its construction, its meaning. I have a lot of material there, and I really have to figure out how to do it justice. And there's lots more to say, and I won't say it here, but there's lots to say about Indian play. There's lots to say about African and African diasporic masking traditions and carnival. Right? There's a lot to say there, but I want to kind of keep my thread going, but I'm happy to talk more about that. When I asked her about this suit, she said, among other things, quote, "And I felt so good because that suit was the heaviest suit I ever made. Not in weight, every suit that I make is heavy. They'll tell you all my suits is heavy. But that was the heaviest suit I ever worn in the 7 years I wore a suit because it felt like I had every woman warrior in my life that was on me. My grandpa, he was a warrior, but I'm talking about the women. Every woman that was in my life was on that suit, and she, meaning my god, meaning her godmother, my mother, was one of the last ones that was on that suit. I felt like that was one of the heaviest suits, but I promise you, it was one of the lightest suits I ever made. Man, I felt good. I really did. Thank you."
Thank you. I have so many reactions. One thing that I hope is obvious to everybody and everybody watching online is that we should never think that the presence of, that the Black presence in the archives has been exhausted, because it has not. And in fact, this is the ideal time for scholars and graduate students and even undergraduates to turn back to the archives. You know, it's, many of my friends, people that I admire, are saying, we shouldn't be limited to the archives, we should engage in acts of imagination. No one's ever accused me of not engaging in acts of imagination. That's true. However, we are a long way from being able to say, there's nothing more in the archives. So rather than encouraging people to fantasize outside of the archives, which is fine, I'm encouraging them to dig more deeply into the archives, because we have decades and decades and decades of scholarship still buried in the archives. There's just an article published by a guy, it's very speculative, and I haven't had a chance to analyze it yet, but he's claiming that he's found, I think, 9 poems that Phyllis Wheatley, which were published anonymously, written by Phyllis Wheatley. That's just one little tiny example. And now, because of Transatlantic Slave Trade Database and a zillion and one other projects, and especially the 10 Million Names Project by Richard Cellini, which is one of the things that I've learned, thank you for the nod about genealogy, is that you can tell history in a complex and compelling way from the particular to the general, by going back on someone's family tree and then contextualizing a document. What makes Finding Your Roots work is that we contextualize, we turn the data into narrative, right? And that's what you're doing, and doing brilliantly. You see a wedding notice from 1866, and you're able to tell a story. And it's another way of telling African-American history. Really, it's from the ground up. It is going from the particular to the general, instead of, like so many historians do, from the general to the particular, or sweeping generalization based on, a couple footnotes. Right? This is a richer way to do it. So I wish all African Americans would do their family tree. Yeah. I love the move of the historical profession, long holding, in scorn genealogists, yeah. right? Because they didn't have a union, right? Like we do, because we have a PhD and yeah. they don't. And more scholarship is the result of partnerships between professors and really superb genealogists. Two bits of contextualization. One, as you said, between 1830 and 1860 was the largest economic boom in American history because of King Cotton. And that was the movement of 1 million African Americans from the Upper South to the Lower South in order to plant, harvest, you know, sow, reap, pick all that cotton. Does 1809 come into your narrative when all these people who from Saint-Domingue, which became Haiti, of course, on January 1st, 1804, all these guys didn't just disappear. They took their slaves and they went to Cuba. But then because of the Napoleonic Wars, and you talk about going down the rabbit hole, you don't want to get into that, because the stuff that happened in Spain, all these people had to flee because they got kicked out of Spanish Savannah, and they went to New Orleans, and the black population doubles overnight, really. I mean, free and enslaved. Is that part of your story?
Not in the way you'd expect. I mean, so my first, in Slavery's Metropolis, I spend a lot of time on that in the first chapter because you're right. I mean, that migration, especially 1809, transforms the city and urban slavery. So I spend a lot of time on that particular migration in the first chapter of Slavery. In Slavery's Metropolis. What's interesting here is that it does figure, but in contrast, so I left out all the sub-arguments, right? But we associate Louisiana with the French, right? And we think it's a sort of, you know, that it's a welcoming place for the French. These people hate the French, right? Like, and so in some ways, it's really interesting. Like, you see deep anxiety kind of in that 1809, 1810, 1812 statehood moment. There's deep anxiety with Louisiana statehood. Will our region be included with New Orleans? You know, if so, if you leave us out, then you'll have a state in the U.S. that's dominated by French Catholics. Do you really want that, right? Like, sure. This is a site that will kind of balance out the Frenchness of other parts of Louisiana. So in some ways, it's a kind of reverse, or I don't know the word here I want, but reverse, a sort of negative image what I'm up to here in that period, because many of these people are Anglo-American settlers from the Carolinas. Right. They don't necessarily come from that same tradition of the French that we think about and dominates our perception of Louisiana. I mean, there are Catholic priests there, but one of the other threads that I didn't get to is I want to trace sort of Baptist and sort of Protestant belief through this, and there is a through line there. It's more American than you would think for a history of Louisiana, and that's right. Part of what I find fascinating, because it's very different from what you get here. And I think there are many misperceptions about Louisiana, and one of them is that you don't have a meaningful kind of thread that kind of comes from this very different tradition in the state. And maybe even Dean can talk about it, because you can almost sense it, sort of the difference between New Orleans and Baton Rouge, right, even into the present.
Yeah, I mean, these million enslaved people didn't come, by themselves. White people brought them down. White people were moving from the Upper South to the Lower South because there was gold in their hills, and the gold was cotton. I mean, sorry, I'm mixing. What did Du Bois call the Silver Fleece? The Silver Fleece. People were going broke, like your guys. Yep. They moved to New Orleans. I mean, they moved down there to the Black Belt, the Cotton Belt, and they became zillionaires. The image that you have of the South in slavery from Gone with the Wind, that is all plantation cotton economy, absolutely, without a doubt. How about, you mentioned 1830, and then I'll pass the mic here to our geographical wizard.
See if he can redeem himself.
The 1830, the Indian Removal Act, signed by Andrew Jackson, which made the five civilized tribes, as they were known, and they even used that term themselves, Creek, Choctaw, Chickasaw, Cherokee, and the Seminole, all of whom owned black slaves, right? And then they moved to their own country, as it were, Indian territory, which in 1907 becomes Oklahoma. Does that movement fit into your story in any way?
Yes, absolutely. Several things. I know someone who's working on right now, sort of thinking about working at the intersection of indigenous and black histories sort of in this region. And so we'll get, I think, really interesting new scholarship to come. For my purposes, obviously there's a lot of desire for this land, right, and a lot of sort of demand for this land, and these are folks who are deeply supportive of and happy to take advantage of various federal policies to get access to that land. The Choctaw, right nearby, right, this region is obviously very close to Mississippi, is kind of Mississippi, right, like it's kind of right there, right, and so they are very much part of this larger Choctaw world, and so they're definitely affected by that, both before and after removal, right, and so that's why I wanted to really kind of emphasize the importance of the indigenous presence there, and though I need to kind of keep bringing that to the fore. But after, I mean, it gets weird, right? And I mean, I know we have scholars of indigenous history here, but I mean, you'll see in the, I mean, that same paper that I put, you know, where you'll see runaway ads, you'll see that they are printing, I mean, almost as soon as Indian removal happens, you start to see the kind of romanticized, you know, Aboriginal oratory, right? And they'll reproduce speeches that are beautiful but haunting speeches that people are giving in defense of themselves, and these are appearing in planters' newspapers in tiny, you know, in 1830s, 1840s, like in real time. And you know, obviously, indigenous people remain after Indian removal, and so people like Solomon Northup talks about seeing people, right? And so, like, there's definitely salience both to Indian removal as this kind of act that opens, like, you know, and we know the number, but I don't have it at the top of my head, but like unfathomable amounts of territory for additional settlement, but also that folks remain there and are, you know, dispossessed. I mean, it just gets really counterintuitive. I mean, I spent far too much time reading like the police jury records, right? And so they have these overseers of the poor, and you see an indigenous man kind of who's getting, you know, state assistance in the context of, you know, Indian removal. It's like the only reason this man needs state assistance is because you took all of his land, right. Like you stole his land, you know. Like it's fascinating.
And that, for those you don't know, that I left it out, that is a Trail of Tears. All those movies that we've seen about the Trail of Tears, they leave out the fact that black people were owned by the Native Americans. Yeah. So that makes you, you know, African Americans, as you know, have long romanticized relationship between African Americans and Native Americans. Mm-hmm. Imagining your great-great-grandmother had those high cheekbones straight, but which is total bullshit for 99% of the cases. But because of DNA. Now, you want facts? Average African American is 24.8% white and 0.8% Native American. Fact, y'all. Wow. Anyway. There were some,
there's fascinating, and there's more work to be done. I mean, I think for reasons we all know, right, the scholarship kind of develops in different grooves, and I think that's why, I mean, I unapologetically fangirl for Taya Miles's work at the intersection of black and indigenous history, because it is so complicated and so thorny and so layered.
One of my teed up is African Americans and Native Americans. For my PBS series.
Oh, nice.
And Taya will be one of my two principal consultants.
Yeah. I mean, her work is beautiful. I mean, just.
That's great.
Yeah.
Good. Questions, comments?
Yes, I have a lot to say. This is amazing. To Skip's point, though, every one of my friends growing up in New Orleans, we all used to say we got Indian in our family, especially girls. Everybody's just like, oh, I got Indian in my family.
Yeah,
but
say West Indian.
Right. Right. I think the title is extremely provocative, Strange Roots, Black Intimacies in the Global Plantation South, because that can be like a double entendre of sorts. I wanted to know about, you know, where we're from in New Orleans. There's like this distinction that a lot of people make between like being Creole versus being black even. And I think that, you know, that always got under my skin growing up when people would ask me, am I Creole as opposed to like, am I black? You know, because there's this breed that has essentially come from, you know, clearly from slaves and slave masters, you know, having kids, to where it's almost like, oh, now you want to fight to preserve like this breed of light skinnedness, you know, and in terms of those roots and how that, when you showed your cousin at the end with the Mardi Gras Indian and taking pride in those roots, I'm curious about the pride that, you know, that gets taken in light-skinned people, essentially, you know, tracing those roots back, knowing that it's like, hey, there's white, you know, there's whiteness that's in my family tree, that I'm not necessarily proud of that and how that happened, but you see so many people wanting to preserve this light skinness that they feel like, especially where we come from, or you from the Seven Ward, you know, or you, And you already know, right? You're like, you part of this social aid and pleasure club. You know, yeah, y'all know
you,
what I mean.
You starting stuff in here.
Yeah, so like, that's, like I have, yeah, no, this is my life. Like, this is like.
This is real.
People don't want to talk about the real black.
Right, so we, so. Right. Yeah. So this.
We are color struck.
So this. Yeah.
So. Yeah.
Right. So, that's something where, like, I put a music video out a while ago. It was a song called Uncle Time, and I talk about the concept of passé blanc in there. My grandmother, so passé blanc is a term to where light-skinned black people essentially choose to pass for white, and live as white people. So. There's a large, I told Skip this when we first met, I don't know if you remember, but there's a large part of my family that I actually don't know, because in New Orleans, they chose to live as passé blanc, and they cut, you know, that generation of my family, anyone who chose to live as black, which they were like, we're cutting y'all off, because we're living as passé blanc, so we can't be associated with y'all or anything. Sure. So the, you know, the pain that comes along with that for people who, like myself, who, you know, have to hear these stories that my grandpa tells of his own family, you know, disowning him because he's choosing not to live as white, or him being in the army and enlisting and having the guy who's filling out his paperwork, you know, checking off white, you know, when he looks at my grandpa, and my grandpa's like, no, I'm black, you know, put black. And he's like, bro, he's like, no, it'll be much easier for you. Just let me put white, you know. Like, no, I'm black, you know? So I just wanted to, I feel like that's a whole thing that I'm, like, super passionate about. And what role does that play in this research?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so that, so I would associate that, so it's not as immediately central, that particular aspect is not as central in this particular story of this particular region for me, but for New Orleans, it's absolutely essential, right? And I think it's the part that, if I may say so, many people who don't really understand New Orleans get wrong, right? Because I think that there's a kind of romanticization of that group of people, right? Because they were really interesting and important in a lot of ways, right? Politically active, educated, people studied in France, people studied at Dartmouth, right? People studied, you know, any number of places. And so that is a track that's very important and tied to that story of the Haitian Revolution and the migration of these gens de couleur, right, to New Orleans. And so it's a rich, fascinating, extraordinarily important history that's easy to romanticize if you leave out some of the less celebratory aspects. Slave ownership, when, you know, did they fight for the Confederacy or not, right? Like, you know, what was the pivot by which they sort of moved into enlisting for the Union and fighting heroically in, you know, in the Battle of Port Hudson? So it's a very complicated history in the 19th century, and it's an incredibly complicated history in the 20th century, because as you talk about, right, passing, very complicated history, and we have very good scholarship. Right, you know, and the kind of the deep pain that comes when certain relatives decide to pass, that absolutely transforms family relationships. The kind of colorism and persistent colorism that we see in New Orleans, like the kinds of stories my mother told growing up, a skinny black girl Baptist in the 7th Ward, like it was ugly, you know, like, and she, I mean, she would talk about, you know, my mother, I mean, she's passed on now, but my mother spoke with enormous pain, and I know some folks were watching who could speak, you know, with enormous pain about, you know, I was in elementary school and I was on the honor roll, but I knew I wouldn't be able to be at the front of the pageant because I didn't look this way, right? I looked this other way, and my mother, like that stayed with her, like, you know, and so that kind of, like, that's a very painful, contested history that also has to be situated in the context of the ongoing making of binary racial logics in a context in which we know that's always been a fiction, sure. Right? Because the other problem I have is that it's very easy to talk about this in the context of New Orleans for obvious reasons, but there are people who have similar stories from all over the place, right? Like, and this is not unique to New Orleans, right? This is, you know, my running joke about that I say in class to try to lighten things, especially with my undergraduates, is like, you know, the thing that's new about interracial sex is not the sex part, it's the race part, right? Like, and so in terms of thinking about the ways we understand the kinds of categories and fictions that get perpetuated through this kind of one-drop binary racial logic never matched the messy, complicated realities that people experienced, not only in New Orleans, because that's another trick people like to play. Oh, that's some weird New Orleans stuff, and that doesn't apply to us. No, like, nope, that's everywhere. And so, yeah, I mean, but I think that that's a very rich and important question.
And it is still here with us in African-American culture.
Yeah.
Make no mistake about that. Though, if you're my age, and I was, 18, Black is Beautiful, 68. We thought it would all be over. Good hair would never be talked about again. People still talk about good hair.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's don't get me started. So anyway, go ahead.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It's good. Yeah. Next.
Hi, thanks, Rashauna. That was really beautiful. My brain's going all over the place. I mean, we've spoken about a couple of things before. But I really love the final image of your cousin and, you know, carrying the generations, because actually, from my experience, genealogy is how Black people have kept archives, oral archives. So they tell the history through genealogy, so you're less likely to forget. You know, one of the reasons my grandfather migrated to Ghana from Sierra Leone is because through genealogy, he'd been told the history, and they didn't believe they came from Sierra Leone. So he was still looking for, you know. And by the same token, you know, when I first went to England, I had to go and meet an aunt, Constance, who was from Sierra Leone, I'd never met. And again, she starts telling me the stories. Oh, well, this one was in Nova Scotia. This was America. This was Trinidad, you know. And so you start to get, but they remember this stuff because it goes through people. But I love the way that you've kind of spoken to your cousin. You've got that part, and then you're looking at the archives. So I'm wondering how you're finding the two of them braiding together, and what is your method for working the two together, and you know, how are you finding that illuminating or frustrating or whatever? Yeah, thank you.
Both and. Thank you for that. So I've been thinking about this for a very long time. My grandmother passed in 2009, and so fortunately I was able to talk to her about some of this stuff before she passed. And, you know, there are moments when I'm able to verify certain things or sort of at least make a plausible, like have plausible support for certain things archivally, right? So if she talks about her mother as being, you know, having, you know, being what we would call, say, so-called mixed race, then I can see in census records where people struggle to classify her, kind of the same issue Dee was just talking about, right? And so that becomes evidence that's useful. But obviously, and I talk about this in the manuscript, like, where would you go to kind of report sexual assault in the 1890s in rural, like, there's just nowhere to be, like, there's that. But, and I think as several scholars have pointed out, like, people talked about this, right? Like Ida B. Wells, or thinking about Crystal Feimster's work, or I'm thinking about Danny McGuire's work, or like any number of Brittany Cooper's work. Like, people talked about this. And so there are ways to, and there are a few testimonies that I'm able to get in terms of thinking about the landscape of sexual violence in this period during this region. But there are interesting moments where there are disjunctures, and I just tell the truth about that and leave it to the reader to figure out what to make of it. So for example, my grandmother was very specific about a postman. She gave the person's last name. I didn't leave it here. I'm still trying to figure out, again, my first book was on the turn of the 19th century. And so as we get deeper into the late 19th century and early 20th century, I'm having to think a lot about how to do this, right? Like how to do this ethically and so on. So I didn't name the last name that my grandmother named. Which is interesting in its own way, because I wonder, you know, had she been younger, would she have told me that story, or, you know, had the stakes been different? You know, I'm not sure. But the point is, I had a last name and I had an occupation, right? We historians can do stuff with that. what I found, at least, you know, in one source that I think is useful, but I think not without complication, was three women listed as post like as the as the officials tied to the post office. I was like, well, what do I do with that? Like, I don't exactly know, right? I'll tell the truth about that, right? That I don't see a person with this name, with this occupation listed in this region, but, you know, here are some other plausible ideas, because I think there are, that people with that last name are in that region. So I think there's a way to kind of think about it. I like a messy story. Like, I don't shy away from messiness. So for me, that raises another set of questions. Like, okay, what are these women doing? Like, why is this happening? Like, what, you know, we have all sorts of interesting work on gender in the New South, right? Like, so how is gender being remade for these white women in the post-emancipation South? Or, you know, like, I mean, I just think that there are any number of rich avenues. And so I think the short answer to the question is, I do my best to kind of fact check, or kind of, and I really don't even like that phrasing, because it suggests that what comes orally is like needs to be checked against the archives, and I think that's a troubling thing to say. But to the extent that I'm able to try to sort of figure out whether or not I can reconcile these things, I do my best. And when they seem to be irreconcilable, that's okay too. Like, let's talk about it and figure out why, and figure out, and you know, what each path perhaps represents.
Can I
turn
then,
Kimberly?
Hi. Thank you for a wonderful talk, Dr. Johnson. I was very excited to see Veronica. I was like, who's Veronica?
I know, we're using different names today.
We have many names. So, you know, I'm working on our family from a different aspect, and you're teaching me all about the archive. And you talked a little bit about this with dealing with the sexual assault. But what I've run into in interviewing some of the women in our family is, my mama said, not every story is yours to tell.
Yeah.
And so what are sort of your boundaries, and what is your ethic of care in dealing with the stories of our family?
I mean, I think that's a very good question. I mean, I think to the extent that I plan to talk about sexual violence specifically, like I've mentioned it sort of in the way that I did, right? Not meditating for a very long time, being very judicious, telling the truth about the, you know, the story itself, right? Because I think it's important, but not sort of, you know, being very careful in terms of the way that I narrate it. I think that's part one. Part two, I'm incredibly protective of my cousin. And that's why I have those big red letters there. I mean, there are reasons for that. I mean, that's a whole other thing. But, and you know, people just take pictures of Mardi Gras Indians and then put them on tote bags or any number of things and then just sell them, right? And that they don't get that money. These are largely working class people who can't afford, you know, like they don't, I mean, you know, like it's just, and it's striking the kinds of places these images land, right? And so I don't want to participate in that, right? And so I've had a lot of conversations with her about, like, sort of what are your boundaries. I don't intend to talk about her beyond this suit, because I do think that it is important to understand ourselves to be sort of living within history, even as we're writing about history, right? And so I want to, I mean, and that in some ways goes back to where I started. You know, I do think that there's something important about the critiques of historical methods when we aren't attentive to, you know, these precisely these kinds of issues. So most of the book is archival, as you can see, I think as you've got the sense from the presentation, right? And so it only gets to kind of family testimony in this very specific way. And it's kind of surrounded by, even in the post-emancipation period, a whole lot of archival work. I mean, the problem with the post-emancipation period is, I mean, I thought I had documentary maybe that was Freudian, researching the earlier period. But I mean, there are lots of documents for that later period. And so, you know, I think that really doing my best to tack between those different levels and through those different methods is the way that I intend to do it, because I think you're right. I mean, I want to be, I still have to show up to family dinner.
What are we gonna do, not censor the tradition? Do you know what I mean? It isn't,
I think, your story to tell. It's very complicated. But for the larger good, I mean, I get all in people's family business, right? I tell them things that they wouldn't even know, like your daddy ain't your daddy, but your daddy don't know.
Sometimes. Oh my gosh. Oh my God.
Sometimes a woman would have slept with two men and then had to made the call and guess the wrong guy, right, or whatever. And this is not only black people, this is all kind of people. My wife always just says, women were playing as much as men, and it's true. Well, you know, I don't want to. She finds it very liberating to be able to say that, that people were exercising choice about their personal lives. And we all know about rape on the other end and coerced sexuality. But I've had many times to make a decision about, not with finding roots. When you're finding roots, whatever we find, that's just the way it's gotta be. You have no control. But we do. If I was doing your family tree, and I found out that your father wasn't your father, I would call you. We have an ethics protocol, and I keep it in a file, and I read it. And I say, we have discovered something in your DNA that is forever going to know, I'm memorizing, I'm reciting from memory, which is forever going to alter your understanding of your family. Do you want to know or not? So far, everybody said yes, of course. We said, well, the man you called your father is not your biological father. What? The man you called your father is not your biological father. This is easier if everybody's dead. But if your mother, and this is, I got a couple cases pending right now when people are deciding what they want to do. Their mother's alive, but their father's not their father. I mean, and so then we say, if you can bow out of the series now, but if you stay in the series, millions of people are going to find this out because we have to tell that story. So it is a complicated ethical thing. And if forget 2 million viewers, if you're writing a book and this is a story that, say, 20 people are going to be pissed off at you forever as opposed to getting tenure or getting an advance, you know, complicated ethical things there. I didn't mean to put it in such a cynical way about the advance. But for the sake of the story that you're telling about the African-American experience, which is going to have enormous implications for generations to tens of thousands of people, as opposed to these 20 people at your Thanksgiving dinner not going to let you come to Thanksgiving. What do you do? That is, maybe use pseudonyms, right? Yeah. That's a way to think about it, or something else, but it's very complicated. I want the story told in all of its messiness, because I think that we have had to bury the complexity of our own history because of profound concerns about embarrassment, when it is better to tell the story and just get rid of it, right? To you know, lance the infection. I think that it's just better, because when family silences, I have found, get passed down, people say, something is wrong back there and I don't know what it is. And it causes a trauma anyway, though it's not named, it is palpable. It is perceived. Mm-hmm. And so, anyway, I'm rambling, but you see what I'm saying? I just think we should just tell the story. And, you know, grandma slept with two people, so what? And I'm speaking from experience, because in Color People, my memoir, my grandmother, who was a saint, she had 12 children, but her first child she slept with two men, and either she guessed wrong, or the story was she went to one guy, he said, I'm not ready to get married, so she married the other guy. And when this child came out, he looked just like the other guy, right? And this was the dark family secret in the Coleman family, my mother's family. And I told the color people, man, people got pissed off. They called me and they said they had a family room, they're gonna sue me. I said, you better have deep pockets. You know, everyone. Skippy, we're telling them lies, you know, about our family. But now the people hating me are dead, so we're all over. Tell
the story. That's what I think.
I know.
It's tough. It's on. Sorry. Rashauna, this is really so beautiful and so multifaceted. So I thank you for that. I love that you started with the image of the two trees, because this really is, I refer to your project before as a series of tributaries, right? It's like opening to a larger body of water. And so I thank you for that as well. And I really appreciate historians for what you did. As I like to say, some of my best friends are historians. I cannot do what you do. So my question is, each time that you were discussing an archive, and I can start with your cousin's production, that costume that was made, that does not need to be photographed within the body of the book. I think you can describe it fully and everybody would get what you were saying or what you were describing. So that pulls that ethical quandary out of. Besides, I find her words so much more, you know, palpable in that context. So that's one part of it. But then at each moment where you were discussing an archive, I just thought about the kind of absent presence of Black women where, as I mentioned before, I'm working on representations of slavery in the contemporary era, and I kept getting data dudes, historian dudes, saying there were very few Black women enslaved, which I found astounding. Like, where are you going with this piece of information? Two, it's false. Three, I call them data dudes because they sidle up after a talk, never during the Q&A, to tell me that the reason why there's so little representation of Black women, enslaved Black women, is because there were so few. This is a need. This is not, there's nothing bounded in fact here. They need this to be true. So I find that wild. And you know, on the other side of that, routinely white women would say, but weren't enslaved women and white women basically besties because they had the same issues going on? Like, isn't marriage kind of like slavery? So these questions are built on need, and they're addressed to a kind of like I'm a black canvas. They're just throwing paint on. So I want to know from your point of view, from your archive, how you will account for the Harriets and the, you know, the kind of like post-production of duplication that necessitates their presence and their reproductive capacities, and then slides them out of the archive, even so much outside of like a planter's journal or, you know, some message or your General Jefferson's farm book. There's no there, even though they are there, and they are so there that you couldn't duplicate a plantation without them, or you couldn't reproduce a plantation without them. So each turn of the archive that you mentioned through your talk seems to be kind of gravitating towards a larger argument that I don't know that you're making about the centrality of Black women within this space and how you are going to account for those kind of absences, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes total sense. Well, thank you for that. One, I'm not entirely sure who's saying Black women weren't enslaved. I would love names. I would love that. We historians are a contentious bunch, so we like to go back and forth about those kinds of things. And I will say, right, like I do my best to read a lot, right? And these are those moments when I find some of my more quantitatively inclined friends to be useful, right? Because I do think that there is something useful about being able to say, okay, based on your ways of knowing and based on the things you actually respect, you're still wrong, right? Like, there's something useful about that. But beyond that, right? And you know, it's always hard trying to explain this to people. You know, students especially, are like, okay, well, how do you write history or how do you do this? You know, I do, my own take here is that I think it's important to move at full speed in two seemingly opposite directions at the same time, right? Because I am deeply committed to archival work for the reasons we've talked about, right? And the reasons you mentioned, right? Like, I think that there is something interesting, important, useful, illuminating about seeing the ways these folks come to us in these archival documents and to what ends, right? I think that there's something important about that. And so I do tend to be really archival, right? Like, and that is a thing that I know. I don't put forward the argument that it somehow exempts me from thinking about some of the more fundamental challenges that people are raising about archive, the nature of archival methods. And so I do a little bit of both and, right? Like, I do my best, and I hope I gestured toward it here, but we'll continue to tease it out in the course of the larger project, to do both, right? How do we see what's happened with these fragments in the archive, and what do they tell us? And how do we continue, how do I, as the narrator, right, make sure that I am using my power, as limited as it may be, to continue to point and insist on thinking about and beyond and to spe- you know, again, I don't know how this got so contentious, right? Historians speculate all the time. I don't really know how this, you know, I do get it. But, you know, I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with sort of imagining the different life worlds that a person might have inhabited. I think where it gets dicey is that I think, you know, my sensibilities would be to kind of flag when I'm doing that in a particular way, or to say, like, this is what I'm getting from this document, here's what I'm doing, here's how I... But, I mean, I think that historians often, like, I mean, we all, I mean, in every sort of way, not every, right? Maybe that's overstating things, but I think many, there's a very, I guess here's how I would put it. I think there's a very long, in the same way that I gestured toward archivists, there's a very long history of Black history, right? And Black historians and historians of Black people for a very long time have been working through techniques to try to think through ways to draw on archival methods alongside other kinds of methods to think about and to do justice to Black life and death in, you know, in my context, say, in the Atlantic world or in the modern era. And so I think it's important for us to do that. And I think that's why it's particularly important, you know, that this space exists, right? Because I am both historian, but I do come from a Black studies tradition, right? And so I don't think I feel as beholden to any particular disciplinary conventions. I think it's really just a matter of sort of thinking through how to make the different kinds of claims legible, because I do want to be able to have many different kinds of fights at the same time. And so I think it's really just about sort of being clear, you know, on what I'm doing and when I'm doing it and to what end. But, and I also really appreciate your point in terms of thinking about really going forward with centering Black women in the story. That is definitely something that I'm trying to do.
Will you take two last questions?
Yes.
From John and Regan?
So thank you so much for that beautiful and really moving, I thought, talk. And I would like to just, I have a lot of comments, but I'll just ask a quick question. Skip mentioned 1809, and I'd like to ask you about 1811 and whether the German Coast Rebellion is felt in the archive of East Feliciana Parish, and yeah.
Yeah, you know, that came up for me. it's really interesting because for me, 1811, in this context, let me back out. Few people in my world talk about the 1810 West Florida Rebellion, right? It's just not on the radar. Let me step back, and I know Jim's in the room. This region is like home to a whole lot of, I mean, as you know, a lot of very important Black history, but it just doesn't get the kind of attention that I think it really deserves, right? Like the Civil War historians know all of this stuff that happens in this context, or the historians of British West Florida, right, know all this stuff. But really sort of thinking about these things together feels like a useful thing to do sort of by itself. So that's kind of the first point. So even just sort of thinking about 1811 in the context of 1810 for me feels important in terms of thinking about, you know, a kind of nearby rebellion, this time by free white people, but it's not entirely unrelated, that then the people who would have been around for that 1810 rebellion by, you know, a handful of people in this region would then in 1811, you'd see this huge, and for people who don't know what I'm talking about, the 1811 revolt, German coast, sort of the largest enslaved, you know, rebellion, uprising of enslaved people in the US, though because it's part of sort of territorial Louisiana at the time, it kind of falls out, you know, for the reasons we've been talking about. But it's a really important, monumental rebellion that really deserves as much attention as it's getting. To the extent that it's relevant there, in the sources I've consulted so far, I don't see like a whole lot of sort of specific kind of this thing happened in this way, therefore we need to, but there is a broader sense of we need to, right? We need to think about defense. We need to have a fire department. We need to, right? Like there's this whole moment, and my second chapter is about entirely this, like building a society. Justin, here's an urban planning, like it's kind of, it makes me think about this because you can kind of see them. They're like, okay, where are the roads going to go? Where are the, you know, like who are going to be the overseers of the road? Who's going to be, and to my mind, all of that is a reaction to this 1811 rebellion where they're trying to really kind of build a society to prevent precisely those kinds of uprisings. And so you see, like, and so to my mind, like in these kind of very granular local records, like the stuff that we might see as just sort of normal state building takes on this kind of valence when you understand that not only are they operating in the context of 1811, but again, some of these folks, I mean, they're talking to people who have fled the Haitian Revolution, right? They are not, this region has been, you know, there's Pointe Coupée in the 1790s, you see rebellions and so on, right? So there's this very long history of resistance and rebellion in this region, and they're very attentive to it as they're thinking about state building and power in that region. So yeah, thank you.
But it's important to add, the people who went to Havana weren't fleeing. It's important to add, I mean, but just so there's no clarity, these are people who left to protect slavery and to keep their slaves, right? Because obviously slavery is illegal in the Republic of Haiti, because it's a black republic.
Yeah. I mean, but the thing, yes, absolutely, right? So that's the draw, right, that they can bring their human property. But they also brought tales of, you know, woe, right? And they were really angry, and they were really, you know, frustrated by what happened. They were very bitter. And you see that as part of the kind of public discourse in Louisiana. And so that even more kind of stiffens their resolve to make sure that does not happen again, right? And so I think that's important context for some of the, for that question and for sort of the broader.
Because 1831, Southampton, Virginia did have Nat Turner, right? So they were right to be worried. Oh, yeah. And 1822 in Charleston.
Yep.
Too.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much for your talk. So I wanted to this might pick up on what you were just saying about like a history of African-American historians and using these different tools to do justice to black life. But I wanted to like pick up with what your cousin was saying, like the heavy history of how the memory is heavy, or this history is heavy. And I saw this quote, like history can be the, I don't know, the counter to memory in a way, or like history can like stomp out memory. But I think, you know, there are historians now who I think are, you know, pushing against that with including family history and memory in their books. And so I wondered, if you plan to include like your own memories in the book, but my question was also about what you think about like this meaning of people of African descent including their memories in these historical texts, and is it something like particularly imperative, like that brings us kind of beyond the veil of the archive as well, or and what can be found there? So just what you think about this sort of turn to family history.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, I hesitate. I mean, that's an important question, but I kind of hesitate. I mean, I would think of that sort of historiographically and sort of understanding why people are making moves in certain directions, but I'd like to do it later. I think that's the historian in me. I'd like to kind of reflect on that question in 20 years. But if I had to kind of guess or sort of give a provisional answer to, I think, that very important question, you know, yes, one to validate. I do think that family history has become much more sort of central and important and useful, especially in African American and African diasporic history, but also beyond, right? Like I think there are a number of really rich family histories of people who don't identify as people of African descent. And so I think that's important to note as well. So I think there's something particular, but I think it's also part of a larger phenomenon. And I know there are other historians in the room, certainly invite you to weigh in. What I come to is sort of thinking about the richness of family, right, in terms of having access to a certain set of memories that you don't always have access to, and a certain set of people you don't always have access to. And so there's a very basic, practical kind of concern there. But two, and I think more importantly, we do grapple with the limits of the archive, right? And we do try to take seriously. I think most scholars, I hope most scholars of people of African descent understand knowledge production and the problems that come with knowledge production according to the rules of many of our received disciplines. And I think this represents yet another, I think, very important way of pushing past or sort of trying to think about creating space within history, right? Like I think any number of people would really want to insist, right, that this is history, and sort of broadening the definition of what history is in a way that can incorporate people's understandings of themselves that I think are historically constituted and sort of easily situated within these family stories. I think three, and I'm not sucking up here, but I mean, there's a reason you have a show, right? Like, I mean, I think there's another point, which is that many African Americans themselves want to know about their families and their family histories, and I think that that's important. I think that in many academic conversations, it is easy to sort of think about what we as academics care about, and that's important. Like, I'm an academic, I care. But I think it's also important to remember that other academics aren't our only audience, right? Other people have other needs and other concerns that they bring to the study of the past, right? And I'm thinking about Jim's comments about temporalities, but you know, I think that you know, people bring a lot of imperatives to this study, and I think that this represents, as much as it kind of expands some of the boundaries of the discipline of history, I think it also responds to the interests of a lot of people who want to use this as a lens for thinking about their own stories and the stories of African Americans more broadly.
There are two kinds of family history, and that's implied in your question. One is the family lore. Yeah. The way I heard it, Uncle Jim said at the last family reunion, we always, for everybody, have them fill out every story that they have ever heard of. And almost everyone has an aunt or an uncle who is the family historian. And just tell us what you've heard. And then we go to the archives. Almost never is it right, but it's where there's smoke, there's fire, right? Because of the game of telephone. You all know telephone. You sit in the circle, I whisper to you, you whisper to him, by the time, just with five people, it's a completely different story. So things just get rearranged. It's not reliable. It's interesting, but of itself, because a family has passed down this story, does not make it true, right? So that you have to think of it almost as parallel family histories. The one that a genealogist would tell from the archives and the one that the oral tradition tells.
There's one other thing I would add, which is that the very eminent historian Martha Hodes has a beautiful piece in the most recent AHR that talks about her own. It's a meta kind of piece, right, that talks about her own thoughts and ideas and feelings in relation to writing about something from her own childhood. And it's absolutely beautiful and brilliant and kind of takes up some of these questions about sort of the historian part of her brain and sort of the memoirist part of her brain and the struggles between them and sort of really trying to figure out how to reconcile those things or how to sit with them when they are irreconcilable. And I think it's brilliant, so.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, happy Thanksgiving,
everybody.
We'll
see you after the holiday. Well done.
Thank you so much, Professor Kane. Thank you.
You call me Skip.